Good day everyone. In this history session, we shall be discussing the rise of the Travancore king Martanda Varma. The Travancore king Raja Rama Varma had instituted a system of administration and revenue in his country. For this, special agents with the power to collect revenue were appointed in the country, which was divided into districts. These officers were directly under the authority of the king, which destroyed the power of the Medapamar and petty chiefs. Sadly, due to the death of Raja Rama Varma, the new system of revenue collection could not be implemented successfully, and anarchy prevailed mainly in the southern part of the kingdom. It was into such a state of affairs that his nephew, Prince Martanda Varma, stepped in. Being the rightful heir to the throne, Prince Martanda Varma succeeded his uncle Raja Rama Varma to the throne in 1729 at the age of 23. The young prince had come to power when the state was in a pitiful condition of depressed finances, anarchy, and rebellious posturing by the feudal chiefs, almost leading to a civil war-like state. Yet the young Maharaja faced the situation with a firm mental fortitude and courage befitting a king. In order to steady the state of affairs in his kingdom, the young king first set about forming a ministry to provide good governance. For that, he sought the help of the late Maharaja's pool of trusted and loyal servants. The old acting Dalwa or Prime Minister, Arumugam Pillai, was confirmed in his office. Kumaraswamy Pillai was appointed as the Commander-in-Chief, and the Dalwa's brother, Tanu Pillai, was appointed as Kumaraswamy's assistant. Rama Ayan was appointed as the Under-Secretary of State. This set the stage for the beginning of the young Maharaja's reign. The late Raja Rama Varma had entered into an agreement with the Pandyan government by which he agreed to an annual tribute of Rs. 3,000 and obtained from the governor a force of 1,000 horse and 2,000 foot to keep the nobles and chiefs in check. When Maharaja Martanda Varma ascended to the throne, the arrears and tribute was unpaid for a few months. The Dalwa, Arumugam Pillai, was sent to negotiate with the force, which held him captive at Tirkanamkudi. However, in spite of meeting most of the force's demands, the Dalwa was still held captive by them. Kumaraswamy Pillai, the commander-in-chief, was instructed by Maharaja Martanda Varma to march with an army to Tirkanamkudi with the purpose of releasing the Dalwa. The command was successfully carried out and the Dalwa was released. Feeling safe enough in his position, Maharaja Martanda Varma ordered the Pandyan force to march back and requested the Pandyan governor to nullify the agreement that was entered into by his predecessor. Sensing an opportunity to declare their independence, the chiefs and nobles supported Raja Rama Varma's two sons, Kunju Thambi and Raman Thambi. In 1730, Kunju Thambi met the Pandyan governor and presented him a list of false grievances. The governor ordered his agent, Alagappa Mudaliar, to investigate Kunju Thambi's claims in Travancore. Upon learning of the Mudaliar's arrival in Udayagiri and the subsequent inquiry into the claims of the Thambi, the Maharaja sent his secretary Rama Ayan and his assistant Narayana Ayan to the Mudaliar, and they presented documents to invalidate the Thambi's claim. Rama Ayan fully proved the Maharaja's claim to his uncle's throne. The Mudaliar rejected Kunju Thambi's claim. With the renewed outbreak of rebellion, the Maharaja managed to convince the Mudaliar to keep one half of his force at his highness's disposal, which was agreed to by the Mudaliar. The Maharaja, although enraged by the actions of Kunju Thambi, feigned indifference and chose to focus his attention on the affairs of the kingdom. On gaining sufficient strength and numbers, the governor's troops were sent back to Trichinopoli. On the return of these troops and the dispersion of the Maharaja's troops to various stations, the Thambis, nobles and chiefs started scheming and plotting against the Maharaja. The Maharaja had received private intelligence through his spy network about the possibility of an attempt on his life. Two men of the lords of the eight houses had made plans to assassinate the Maharaja during the Auratpasara session. The meeting was held in a house in Venganur. An old man who was a spy living in the building overheard the discussion. The information was passed on to the Maharaja, who did not take action immediately. Arrangements were made to track the movement of the nobles and chiefs. The plan was to attack the Maharaja on the day of the procession when he would be unarmed. But on the day of the procession, the Maharaja turned up well armed at the front of the procession, due to which none of the chiefs or nobles dared attack him. In 1733, for safety reasons, the Maharaja moved himself to Nagarkoil from Trivandrum. Instructions were conveyed through the state secretary Rama Iyan to seize all the nobles and chiefs. One morning, when the Maharaja was seated on his cot in his palace in Nagarkoil, an attempt was made by the Thambi brothers on the life of the Maharaja. In the subsequent events that followed, the two Thambi brothers lost their lives and the nobles and chiefs were seized and presented before the Maharaja in Kulkulam. In the subsequent trial, 42 nobles and chiefs and their associated fellow men were found guilty and executed. The women and children of the nobles and chiefs were made outcasts by banishing them to become fishermen. All their possessions and properties were confiscated by the Sirkar. Thus, the legacy of the nobles and chiefs who had rebelled against the royal house for hundreds of years was put to an end, and perfect peace and order prevailed thereafter. Thank you.